Ja, es ist mir eine ganz große Freude, jetzt zum Abschluss Wendy Chan bei uns begrüßen zu dürfen. Ich hatte mit ihr abgesprochen, ich darf auf Deutsch anmoderieren, sie nimmt es mir nicht übel. Und ich versuche all das zu sagen, was richtig ist, damit sie nicht nachher sauer ist, wenn sie erzählt bekommt, dass ich was Falsches erzählt habe. Wendy Chan ist Professorin an der Brown University und hält dort den Lehrstuhl für Modern Culture and Media. Und sie verbindet aufs Produktivste das Wissen um Theorie und Praxis. Sie hat sowohl Systems Design Engineering studiert als auch englische Literatur. Und es hat viel mit dem Wissen um beide Seiten des Spiels zu tun, dass ihre Überlegungen zum komplexen Spannungsfeld von Kontrolle, Freiheit, Ermächtigung, Entmachtung und auch zu Software als Ideologie so fruchtbar sind und so viel Diskussionen angeregt haben. Sie gehört seit Jahren zu den wichtigsten Stimmen in der Auseinandersetzung mit computerbasierten Medien. Und ich freue mich sehr, dass sie bei uns ist. Aus ihrer langen Liste an Publikationen will ich auch hier nur drei hervorheben, und zwar die Herausgeberschaft New Media, Old Media, History and Theory Reader, zusammen mit Thomas Keenan bei Routledge 2005 erschienen, und dann ihre Monographie Control and Freedom, Power and Paranoia in the Age of Fiber Optics, MIT Press von 2006, ein sehr einflussreiches Buch, und dann Programmed Visions, Software and Memory, MIT Press von 2011. Und derzeit arbeitet sie an einer Monographie mit dem Titel Habitual New Media, und ich glaube, ein Teil ihres Vortrags wird darauf Bezug nehmen. Der Titel ihres Vortrags lautet Vertiginous Boredom, auf Deutsch übersetzt ungefähr schwindelhafte Langeweile, und ich freue mich auf ihren Vortrag. Welcome, Wendy Chan.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you for the organizers for inviting me. I've really enjoyed the exhibit, and I'm excited to be part of this event. I'm also jet-lagged, so I will either talk really quickly or really slowly, and I might oscillate between the two of them. But today, I want to think about the conference theme, the digital threshold, the digital as an entryway and a stumbling block, a lower limit and a saturation point, the digital as a border that exists in order to be constantly transgressed. This is a threshold. I want to think about the digital as oscillating between virality and habituation. So the digital as a viral habituation. That is, I want to link the vertigo, the perpetual motion, the constant movement between and betwixt in terms of its seemingly opposite thing, boredom, or more positively, and I'll argue as more difficulty or impossibly, habituation. For if there is vertigo, a confused and confusing sensation of whirling round and round, it's not simply because we're in perpetual motion, but also because we're simultaneously accelerating and decelerating, right? That is because of constant changes in direction that immobilize, constant changes in direction that make us remain manically the same. So think here of chain emails that never die. And here you see Libin-Noel and Kleinberg's diagram of their spread. Right? So if chain emails were really viral, they would not look like this. They would spread quickly and then die. But rather, they remain, they embody what I've called the undead of information because of our asynchronous habits of responding. Right? So think here of the ubiquitous update, right? So we're constantly reminded to update our software, not only to remain up to date, but in order to remain period, right? And in this sense, hackers are the best thing that ever happened to software companies, right? So to avoid potential security flaws, we constantly download the latest corporate spyware, right? And this ubiquitous update expands beyond software, because for now, one could argue, to be is to be updated. To be subject of and to the update, people no longer updating are people in trouble, things no longer updated are things no longer cared for, no longer usable, right? To be is to be updated because crises become ordinary, drive updates. As Lauren Berlant has argued, the present is now an impasse, a cul-de-sac, and the ordinary landfill for overwhelming and impending crises, whose sheer volume so threatens what it meant to have a life that adjustment seems like an accomplishment. Right? So to update is to survive, if not to thrive. And crucially, Lauren Berlant defines cruel optimism as a double bind. Right? So the thing you cling onto optimistically is also the thing that undermines you. Right? So you cling onto the notion of a good life, the dream of the good life, but it's precisely this dream of the good life that undermines the possibility of building a good life. But it also allows you to survive, if not thrive, to tread water, to live in that cul-de-sac. So here I'm thinking through new media as a form of cruel optimism. Right? In other words, and I argue in my hopefully completed book, the book I no longer have to update, right? Habit plus crisis equals update. Now, since I only have 35 minutes, I need to be rather telegraphic and condensed, so let me apologize for this in advance. But the rest of the talk will oscillate around this formula and the other aphorisms of new media, so the aphorisms that you see here which structure the book. And more specifically, to deal with the digital threshold, I want to outline the remarkable and bizarre transformation of digital media into new media, into a constantly renewed media, and also think through the dizzying perpetual motion in terms of what is arguably its opposite but is no longer possible, silence. So part one, again, new media again. Right? So digital media became new media, the promised future, the marker of progress in the mid-1990s with the emergence of the internet as a mass media to end the very notion of mass media. The term new media, which itself is always on the verge of its obsolescence, it's always embarrassing to use the term new media. It's always been embarrassing to use the term new media. It's always been a term that we're constantly trying to get rid of in a so-called critical stance, right? New media displaced more friendly terms such as multimedia, which implied everyone could live in a happy plurality, right? Or digital media, which implied a model of conversion, right? And this newness of new media, importantly, did not coincide with the newness of technology, right? Computers and networks were not new in the mid-1990s when they emerged as new media. Instead, the term new media coincides with the deregulation, the mass deregulation of the US telecommunications industry, right? So new media became new when it became fictional, when it became a new frontier, right? Conflated with something it could never be, right? It became conflated with cyberspace, the matrix, right? And there's a huge difference between Gibson's fiction, which coined these terms, right, and the internet itself. And if you've read Neuromancer, it's very clear that Gibson wrote it on a typewriter, right, while visiting video arcades, right? There's a certain notion of navigability that's central to his fiction. That is, and as I've argued in Control and Freedom, the idea of digital media as progress, inevitable progress, had everything to do with a bad and yet not entirely unfaithful reading of 1980s cyberpunk fiction, in which political problems became reworked as problems that technology could solve, right? So for instance, consider the bodilessness of cyberspace. This became, in the mid-1990s, the solution to racism. And let me just show you an influential TV commercial.
There is no race. There are no genders.
There is no age.
No age.
There are no infirmities.
There are only minds.
Only minds.
Utopia?
No.
No.
The internet.
Where minds, doors, and lives open up.
All right, so in the mid, and this was one of just many internet TV commercials on television, and in the mid to late 1990s, it seemed impossible to advertise the internet without featuring happy people of color saying there is no race. And let me just note that this commercial does not only assume that racism naturally stems from race bodies. Like, the message isn't even don't discriminate, it's get online if you want to avoid being discriminated against. There's also a paranoid logic to this, right? So in the mid-1990s, not only weren't there a lot of people of color on the internet, there weren't a lot of people, period, right? But the message of this commercial is get online because these others are. And what's interesting is when internet usage took off, these commercials disappeared. But they still were playing in places like Japan, where internet usage had not been taken up to the same extent. So remarkably, through this paranoid logic, the progressive position on technologies, which in the mid-1980s was against technology, right? The progressive position was anti-nuclear, right? The progressive position moved from this anti-nuclear position to this, yay, embrace of technology. Digital media is new even when it's not, right? Now, I make this argument not simply to say new media aren't really new. This is a fundamentally boring argument that assumes that other things really are new. Like, hello, remember the novel? Still called the novel. And it also assumes that somehow we can all agree on what's new, right? But I make this argument because this constant logic of renewing is what's at stake in the digital threshold. The digital as an entryway and a stumbling block. The digital as perpetual vertiginous movement. Because the new doesn't simply mean wondrous for the first time. The new also contains within itself repetition. So the notion of repetition is also contained within the word revolution, right? Think about a revolution. You're going back to the same spot, right? It's a repetition. To make it new is a stock modernist phrase, and it exemplifies the type of repetition encased by the new, the transformation of something already known into something wondrous. But new as renewal also means new as decay. Right? To call something new is to guarantee that it will one day be old. Right? New media exist at the bleeding edge of obsolescence. They're exciting when they're demonstrated, boring by the time they arrive. If a product actually does what it says, it's failed. Right? And if an analysis is interesting and definitive, it's arguably always too late. We're forever trying to catch up, updating to remain close to the same, bored, overwhelmed, and anxious all at once. So to call into the question new media as new, to simply critique it, and to show how it's really old is not even close to good enough, right? Because indeed, what's remarkable is not that new media are constantly called into question, but rather that they continually resurge and spread even as they disappoint. Right? So soon after the dot-com meltdown, right, social media emerged as the new promise. And Web 2.0 promised a new beginning, a new future, although not one as sexy, right, as the web, the future that needed no numerals to qualify it. But think again of Web 2.0. What it also guarantees is that the web will never die, that every temporary thing is simply one version that can be updated to remain close to the same. So rather than treating this twinned ennui and excitement as a response to new media, it's crucial to understand this response itself as being produced by the very concept of new media. So this anticipation coupled with knowing disappointment is key to new media's ephemerality and to its endurance. The seduction and significance of new media lie in this combination of boredom and excitement. Just as the novel quickly became anything but novel, but remained the novel, right? New media, even after its newness has faded, remains in ways that shape our imagination, that shape our politics and our everyday life. We need to grasp the paradoxical lives and deaths of new media. Indeed, the paradoxes of new media more generally, its enduring ephemerality, its visible invisibility, its exposing empowerment, its networked individuation, its obsolescent ubiquity. That is, and this is something that grounds the new book, which hopefully no longer needs to be updated, new media can't survive if it's really wonderful, if it's really singular, if it's really for the first time. As many marketers have shown, most new commodities are ignored, right? This is why grocery stores do that really annoying thing of redesigning the entire grocery store, right? So you'll notice the new commodity, right? Habituation dulls us to the environment. Habituation is both the dream and nightmare of new media companies, as is the new itself. And it's this oscillation between the new and the habitual that's so fundamentally ungrounding. So in habitual new media, I argue that new media matter most when they seem not to matter at all, when they've moved from the new to the habitual, when they've moved from the noteworthy to the barely visible. So new media matter most when you no longer pay attention to them, right? So Google, no longer this wonderful thing, and yet it fundamentally structures your relationship to knowledge. Sites that have long since disappeared, or we think we have, good old Friendster.com, still alive in South Asia as a gaming site. These sites continue to shape our relationship to current social media sites. These media, new media, that is, live on in our habits. Repetition breeds expertise even as it breeds boredom. Repetition breeds expertise even as it breeds boredom. Through our habits, we become our machines. We click, stream, update, capture, upload, share, grind, link, verify, map, trash, and troll. At the same time, though, even as we become habituated to and inhabitants of new media undermines, they seek to undermine, indeed they must undermine, the habits it also must establish in order to be new, in order to succeed. Again, habituation and the new as the dream and nightmare of new media companies. Again, habit plus crisis equals update. Okay, but the point I make in the book, and which I'd like to make here, albeit obliquely through changes in silence and participation, is that this rewriting, this linking of habituation and the new also fundamentally changes habit. So habit is moving from habes to have to addictio to lose. Habits are resurging in the theoretical and popular literature as something that need to be changed, right? Habits are dependencies rather than things that offer shelter. So part two, updating participation. Now, new media is new media, as opposed to new media are new media, because new media was defined negatively against mass media. So new media replaced the mass with a U. New media, in other words, is new media, right? So new media is a function of you. It relentlessly focuses on you. And you in English is a particularly shifty shifter. So you is both singular and plural, but when it's plural, it refers to everyone still individually. It doesn't transform I into we. There's no mass aggregate. Instead, there's always the constant individuation, right? And this is allegedly good because you are no longer silent. You can participate. Hence, new media is good. Now, to state what's been obvious since the emergence of the internet as a mass medium to end mass media, participation does not automatically equal freedom or democracy, right? So we need to ask ourselves, how and why did freedom and democracy become reducible to participation? Where participation, true participation, is allegedly marked by greater difference, right? So the greater the difference, allegedly, the more participation, right? So the logic is like, if Facebook had an unlike button, then somehow it would be more democratic, right? So participation and difference is central. Now, the concept of participation or difference as empowering stems from a rather old critique of mass media, a standard critique from both the left and the right that links silence with oppression. If you're silent, it means you're brainwashed, and thus participation with liberation. And here you see Stuart Hall's influential and inspiring critique of theories of mass media that reveals, importantly, the differences between encoding and decoding. Right? And I bring up this diagram not because I think Stuart Hall was wrong, but I think this is one of the best forms of this critique, and his work has been inspiring. But I bring it up because I think difference and reception are differently recepted now, received now. So new media, in other words, run on differences. Algorithms need mistakes, deviations, in order to learn. Singular events are not exceptions, but are opportunities to learn. They feed the algorithm, right? Crisis plus habit equals update. Deviations are encouraged. In fact, you're encouraged to deviate in order for algorithms to learn better. Decoding drives encoding. To get at this and to rethink the assumption that silence is bad, I want to turn to Jean Baudrillard at his most perverse, right? Jean Baudrillard at his most perverse, not to decide whether or not silence is good or bad, but whether simply to ask, is silence possible? Is silence possible? So this is Baudrillard at his most perverse, the Baudrillard of In the Shadow of the Silent Majorities, and the masses, the implosion of the social in the media. And Baudrillard in these two texts, in his usual completely understated manner, argues that the strength of the masses lies in their silence. Right? So rather than taking the silence of the masses, the so-called silent majority, to be a problem that needs to be fixed, he views this non-response as a form of resistance. He argues that it's a strategic disappearance that reacts to the demand to be liberated, to be enlightened, by refusing choice and subjectivity altogether. So the masses, he argues, are opaque yet transparent. They absorb and neutralize rather than radiate. And again, this absorption, this indifference, is a positive strategy. It's impossible for the masses to be alienated because this silence indicates the refusal to be spoken in their name. It indicates the refusal to be subjects. In other words, the strength of the masses themselves, a medium called into existence through mass media, the strength of their masses is their lack of verifiable reception, their lack of vocal participation. Right? This, of course, and here you see his discussion of silence as an absolute weapon, this, of course, was once simply called reading. Right? And here you see D.A. Miller's characterization of the ontological difference between readers and characters. Now, whether or not one agrees with Baudrillard, and there's certainly a lot to disagree with here, especially in terms of his conflation of indifference with silence, right? I'm not sure how the mass watching of a football game counts as silence, right? Silence as a mocking strategy, as a positive brutality, is arguably now impossible precisely due to the constant measures for testing that Baudrillard dismisses as incapable of capturing the masses because they're on the side of simulation and not representation, right? Which he dismisses because he's fascinated with mass fascination of images, with the implosion of the social in the media. So silence is now impossible, not because of the implosion of the social in the media, but rather the implosion of the media in the social. Because of the rise of a social media in which reception is coupled with response, in which reading is no longer private but tracked, and in which even when silent, we're constantly betrayed by people like you. Because the medium is no longer the mass but you. So part three, like, or the revenge of the Valley Girl. Okay. So New media is new media, not simply because you're always chattering, but because of how you, your reception of how you are captured and compared, how your deviation from the mean is measured and appraised, that is constantly valued. Now, clearly, there's been a lot of media coverage recently about new media and surveillance, and although I don't want to get into this here, let me just note that what's surprising about Snowden's revelations isn't arguably what they revealed, but the fact that they counted as revelations in the first place, right? So the fact that the NSA regularly downloads metadata should have surprised no one. Not only have there been whistleblowers since at least 2006, right? But also, and to repeat something I've been saying for years, new media is not simply about leaks. New media is leak. New media are leaky. New media work technically and socially by breaching and thus bizarrely sustaining the threshold between private and public, right? New media is wonderfully creepy, right? New media is wonderfully creepy because our machines work by leaking. So your network card reads in all data and then actively deletes what's not directly addressed to it, right? So your card works promiscuously without your knowledge. It constantly reads and writes. And this is what I think the men in gray exhibit really brought out beautifully. So I would encourage you all to look at it. It's fantastic. And here, and this one is for any sysops in the room. Okay, this is a humorous joke outlining TCP/IP, right? So outlining the endless back and forth, the endless exchange of information that makes the internet possible. But this constant exchange of information is not just read in by the machines in question, but all machines on a wireless network. That is, your card is monogamous if it is, and tellingly, promiscuous mode, not monogamous mode, is a technical term. Putting your card into monogamous mode would make it inoperable, right? Your card is monogamous if it is because your network discreetly erases its indiscretions, right? So your cell phone reads in the same signal as mine. Your cell phone communicates with your microwave, your cell phone interfere with your signal is my noise. Our devices are deceptively sealed, deceptively personal, but our devices, our computers constantly leak, they're wonderfully creepy. And it's this wonderful creepiness that's not accidental, but central. Without this constant exchange of information, there would be no communication. Having said this, though, I want to emphasize that just because this is necessary doesn't mean it's necessary that it be stored, right? There's a political decision to store all this data, right, and to compare it with other devices. There's a difference between memory and storage. That is, if TCP/IP has become key to surveillance, it's not because of its inherent nature, but rather due to political decisions to store and secure, political decisions to reduce trust to authenticity. And I've discussed this elsewhere in terms of the transformation of the internet into a series of poorly gated communities, right? A series of poorly gated communities which place us at greatest risk precisely because we think we're safe, because there is this threshold between public and private, as though the greatest dangers in this world stem from stranger danger, right? There's a thin edge between friend and enemy, right? Hence the new term, frenemy, right? And in many ways, the whole rhetoric around empowerment, security, and transparency has been exposed as a farce. And it's been exposed as a farce not simply because we can all speak and yet the world is not yet liberated, but also because what matters is arguably not what we say, but how we cannot not say things even when we're silent. So consider, for instance, what happens when you read a book on Kindle. Your highlights are tabulated, used to create lists of the most highlighted texts, used to link you to others like you, right? So even the time you spend on a page is tracked. Okay, but what's more interesting, and the point I'd like to dwell on here, is that Silence is impossible, not only because we're constantly being captured, but because we're constantly being compared to people who like us or people who are like us, right? So frenemies link us more closely into networks. Through their actions, they may clear the ties between nodes, the weight of likeness. Now, this notion of frenemies as linking us more tightly into networks is intimately tied to notions of virality, right? So the notion that now everything spreads like a virus, right? And recent work on virality has been important, but it leads to a privileging of contagion above everything else, right? So consider this infamous study, which allegedly showed that obesity spreads like a virus. And this study has come under attack for many reasons. The most compelling critique of this article was by Shalisi and Thomas, which shows that these models generally confound contagion and homophily, that is, the tendency of people who are like each other to respond alike. Right? So it's difficult, that is, to distinguish between viral spread and habituation. And in many ways, habituation often dampens viral spread. So we can think of habituation as an affect modulator, right? And we're told over and over again, if you want to avoid a virus, acquire the habit of washing your hands, right? So trying to think through the habitual and not simply the viral, as if we were always attacked, right? So I'd like to think of people not only who like us, but people like us, and what the term like us does in terms of defining you as a medium. So the work that this like does in making reality analog. And now it's always really struck me as weird that analogy has become the term for reality for the unfiltered. And I realize that this is due to an erasure of analog computation, and analog computers ran by creating models, right? Models that modeled the same behavior of differential equations that were to be solved in the real world, right? With network analytics, however, the analog is returning with a vengeance. Everything is like everything else. This is what I'm calling the revenge of the Valley Girl, right? And this like is being used to draw links between disparate folks, to create neighborhoods of affinity by correlating habits, right? And through this like, you becomes a medium. Consider, for instance, Netflix's use of collaborative filtering, right? So Netflix has a huge database. It has millions of subscribers and films. At the same time, however, its database of recommendations is really sparse, right? Millions of films, millions of users, not a lot of recommendations. Some people recommend, you know, rank every film. Most people don't rank any, right? So Netflix famously posted a challenge. It offered a huge chunk of its database and a lot of money to whoever could improve on its recommendation system. And for those interested in the algorithm and the techniques of this, Meng Cheng's textbook, Network Life, does a really good job of doing this. Now, the winning algorithm not only took as its base the mean score of the film and factors to compensate for user and film bias, it also created a quote-unquote neighborhood predictor based on strong similarities and strong dissimilarities between films and users. That is, it was based on how and where one deviated most from the norm, where one deviated most from the norm as central actually to predict behavior. Now, Netflix is considered an example of big data or network analytics more generally, and I have more to say on the relationship between big data and habits, but I need to move on, and I need to move on because in the spirit of this conference, I'd like to think of moves to inhabit the digital threshold, moves that perhaps resist this like-like because they inhabit this like-like. So I'd like to end with the work of Natalie Bookchin. And so I'm going to show you part of Mass Ornament. Is it possible to get the lights off for this? Okay, so I'm just going to have this showing and sort of speak over it for the sake of time, but Mass Ornament and her other piece, Testament, which I'm happy to show you in the question and answer period, are amazing examples of what Jamie Baron has called found collectivity. And unlike network analytics, this is not algorithmically driven, right? I think she has an army of graduate students, actually, who go through this. Through this manual sifting, Mass Ornament captures our neoliberal condition in which we're all allegedly private individuals, in which the private corporations, individual rights, et cetera, seems to have triumphed over the public or social. And importantly, Mass Ornament starts with those scenes of homes, right? So it starts with clips of private spaces, but also of screens and mirrors. And this brilliant reworking of Siegfried Krakauer's reading of the 1920s chorus line is reflecting the logic of Fordism, and Krakauer, of course, argued that the masses of rows of dancers equaled the masses of viewers looking forward, and this was the logic of Fordism. This uses rows of YouTube videos in order to reveal collective habituation. Indeed, focused on action shot in the home, Mass Ornament is not simply a negative critique, it's not, hey, we're all the same, but also a hopeful revelation of traces of publicity that form our habits and our seemingly private revelations. For habit, the traces of publicity encased within the self, habit is traces of publicity encased within the self, are arguably what society can be in an era in which there is allegedly no society. And since I'm running out of time, let me just note that habit as culture, habit as second nature, as that which lies at the threshold between nature and culture, indeed makes the nature-culture threshold possible, is wonderfully paradoxical and contradictory. So habit has been theorized as both spontaneous and repetitive, individual and collective, human and inhuman, creative and ideological. What's most remarkable about Mass Ornament and Testament is how they reveal mass habituation. Habit is traces of publicity encased within the self. That is, in an era in which improbability, speculation drives capitalism, drives everyone to be and think different, perhaps what's most radical is the revelation of probability. Right? These pieces are so forceful because they point towards the many thousands of other videos which could have been used but were not. They're so forceful because they're moments of found habituation as much as they're moments of found collectivity. They reveal the traces of medium as mean in what has become social media. They reveal that what matters most isn't indifference from the medium, but rather moments of medium inhabitation, moments that are not simply banal, but also moments of network outage, of hugs that can destroy. Thank you.
Wendy, thank you very, very much for your very inspiring and very lively presentation, which convinced me I need more jet lags, that's for sure. I speak now English to have a conversation, and ich versuche, wenn Fragen auf Deutsch sind, kann ich die gerne versuchen zu übersetzen und werde Marx uns bitten, mir zu helfen. Das kriegen wir auf jeden Fall hin, aber ich werde versuchen, das Gespräch auf Englisch zu führen. If you have any questions, please give me a sign, and you're very welcome to ask or to comment on the presentation.
Can I take your pen?
Of course.
Thank you.
And I would like to start with one question, and with maybe the beginning of your talk. To be is to be updated, mm-hmm. which this inbuilt newness of new media, which is really really. Interesting that this new medium succeeded in convincing us that it's all time new again. Mm-hmm. So it's, and I think it's interesting that we maybe no longer criticize the newness of new media, saying we had this already, but to discuss the way they try to convince us it's every day, not only new, but so new that we have to struggle to be on the same level of this newness. And that reminded me on this inbuilt newness, on the contradictory of the problematic, I don't know if you have the same discussions in the USA. In Germany we had the search for the digital razor gum. Is it razor gum? Radiergummi?
No, eraser.
Eraser gum, okay.
No, just eraser.
Eraser, just, but eraser isn't that Arnold Schwarzenegger, eraser?
No,
sorry. But eraserhead. Okay, because they said nothing disappears ever online. Everything is always there, which is interesting if you search for a video which is no longer there on YouTube. But this is contradictory that you this newness, this all time newness, and this eternity at the same time. And that reminded me of the one that you didn't mention, that Deleuze's idea of controlled society, mm-hmm. and its demand for all day, every day, flexibility and activity. And maybe you can comment on that a little bit.
Yes, absolutely. So to unpack that, yes, so clearly the control and freedom was all about Deleuze's controlled society, and that the constant need to be the individual or active. What I would say is a couple of things about what you brought up. What's really also struck me as interesting about new media and computers is that it's through computers that memory has become storage, right? We no longer store things. If you think about it, it's no longer that we store memory traces, but memory has become storage. Right? It's a bizarre way in which computation, which is itself built on cycles of repetition and ephemerality, have somehow become the permanent thing. So in other words, in order to remain, now nothing remains so that nothing remains as everything does. Right? So what's really strange is that we take things like film and paper, which can actually remain longer, right, and yeah. save them by making them digital and thus more ephemeral, right? So this bizarre logic of the enduring ephemerality. But what that brings up is that if the digital is more permanent, it's because of a constant logic and apparatus of repetition and accessing and of migration. And those are all decisions that are made. They're not, and here I'm increasingly thinking through the question of the default and what the default does. But I would say in terms of the right to be forgotten, which I think is the eraser thing, yeah. I think that the right to be forgotten is too late. I think that the question is the right not to be captured in the first place, right? And so if we thought about it that way, how could we rethink this? Precisely by thinking through the undeadness of information, rather than assuming that we always have to have that default of storage.
Thank you. Henrietta Coleman.
Thank you.
bring you the mic, sorry.
I very much enjoyed the talk. Thanks a lot for it. There was a lot to think through, so I'm really excited for your book. So I guess, I mean, my question maybe is a pretty simple one. I really like how you gave this critical reading of habituation that exists in the context of movement and virality. You ended with an amazing kind of artistic rendition of habituation. Mm-hmm. And I guess my question is whether there is an experiential component to habituation or whether it really exists as habitus. So I guess the question I'm asking is whether people experience habituation, whether there's a way to kind of ethnographically track it, whether there's traces of this habituation, or whether it is kind of so overshadowed by the other kind of side of the binary that people themselves don't experience it.
I think that's a fantastic question. And let me outline two different responses to it. Because one reason why habituation has become so popular in the theoretical and popular discourse is because it's always embodied, right? So it's a move towards the body in a certain way. Now, what's fascinating about the popular discourse about habit is that it's always discussed in terms of habit change. So the idea is you have to become conscious of a habit because you want to change it, right? And so habit isn't automatism precisely because it's something that can be perceived and changed, which is always on the cusp, right? So Wendy Wood, who's a neurologist that works on habit, argues that habit is the vestige of past goals pursuit, right? So habits are things that you take on in order to pursue a goal that then you forget about as they become quote-unquote automatic, but which can always be withdrawn as well. So there's always with habit this idea of a consciousness of it, either at the beginning or because habits conflict with something else. And it's the moment of conflict in which you're allegedly aware of it. Now, I think that's an interesting question, and I think it's too easy to actually buy this idea that we're only conscious of habits in order to change them, precisely because habituation has that double edge. And so for me, I've been trying to think of habit less in terms of the thing you need to change, but the thing that goes on and you inhabit. So for me, it's even less the experience of habit, but the experience of inhabiting as a way to get into these questions.
Are there any other questions or remarks that I cannot see in my back maybe or somewhere? Thomas Elsesser.
Yes, does it work? Thank you very much, Wendy. I was struck by two things. One is what you were saying about silence. And on the one hand, you're quite right in pointing out, you know, how many intellectuals have used silence as you know, a negative term in revolutionary movements and emancipation. An interesting variation on what you were saying is the one from Jacques Rancière, who says people who don't have any time take the time, etc., etc. But as we all know, especially those of us living in big cities, silence is now a huge privilege that only the very rich can afford. Mm-hmm. So we have that as an additional paradox. Mm-hmm. But my actual question was more about habituation, which is a term that I'm not that familiar with as a theoretical concept. And I was wondering about two ways. One is, how does it relate, especially in light of your final example, to what earlier we were discussing about the mimetic impulse that both generates so much attention when it comes to games, but also is a perpetual accusation made against you know, internet and so on as being childish and, you know, infantilizing us. On the other hand, the way that you were going about explaining or working with habituation seemed very close to what I've been calling convenience capitalism. Mm-hmm. In other words, that you know, it's convenience that drives, that gives us, or it's the compensation that we have for giving away so much of our private lives and providing so much data. On the other hand, there is another term, which is intuitiveness. And intuitiveness has always been Steve Jobs' holy grail. Mm-hmm. You know, that digital gadgets have to be intuitive. And I was wondering what might be the relation between the mimetic impulse, habituation, convenience and intuitiveness.
Okay, thank you. This has been fantastic questions. There's several ways into this question. One, I would say, is the way in which intuition has been discussed most, I think, convincingly in terms of habituation is intuition itself is a form of bodily memory. So I'm here thinking of Kara Keeling's work in The Witch's Flight, which argues that, and she's here thinking about the turn to affect in cinema, and she's arguing that if you turn to affect, some people have viewed the turn to affect as a way away from questions of race. And she's saying, no, it's actually through intuition and so for bodily memory that raced experience is important, right? And Lauren Berlant also thinks through the question of intuition in terms of this embodied memory. So that's one way into it. I think as well with the question of habit and why I'm pushing back on the notion of virality and mimetic, the mimetic impulse isn't because I don't think the mimetic impulse isn't there, but rather because habituation implies a certain time delay, right? Things don't automatically become habits. There's a way in which there's a slowness to habit acquisition that's then seems to take over and shut down a lot of mimetic impulses. So I think it gets us away from the overemphasis on affect and atmospheres to try to think about the ways in which we ignore these things and how we can ignore these things. I think as well, what habit's been also thought about in terms of creativity, and here this is Liz Gross's argument drawing from Bergson, is that we need habituation in order to be creative. If we didn't have habituation, we'd never have creativity because we'd never have the time to be creative, right? But also another argument is if habit's second nature, this is a sign of human creativity, right? For there to be this creation of the second nature is absolutely fantastic. So I think that for me, the question of the time delay is something that I really think we need to think through and occupy and inhabit a little more.
Any other questions? So you have to stop me then. Mark.
I also want to thank you for this very inspiring talk, and there are very many things I would like to ask you about, but maybe just jumping into the line of inquiry that was going on. thinking about habit and thinking about the what you were saying, habit frees up time or it frees up energy. You know, it lets us do things automatically so that we have resources to do other things. You know, it's a very important function. I personally am suffering from a lack of habituation at the moment just because I'm living in the state of constant change, in my life and maybe the world around me. That might be something that one could think about, you know, being influenced by this progression of digital media and these, you know, neoliberal fluid times that we're living in. That's one thing I would like to ask you about. But the other thought that came to mind listening to Thomas pose this question is also that, you know, in biological play theory, there's a very interesting relationship between play and habit that, you know, some structural evolutionists have postulated, saying that, you know, play comes into being, you know, some 250 million years ago in the animal world as a way of, making habits become more malleable and plastic so that they can change and better adapt to their environment. So I was wondering if you had given that any thought.
Great. So again, fantastic question. I think that the question of the lack of habituation is exactly what I'm trying to think about in the move from habit to addiction, right? So one of the most influential books on habit is Duhigg's, what is that? The Habit Thinking something or other, Charles Duhigg, the something of habit. Anyway, this one's due to jet lag, let's say that, as opposed to, you know, I'm just getting old, it's okay. So I think what's interesting about his examples of habit is that there are things like alcoholism, right? So what's increasingly being pegged as habit is actually what we would consider to be addiction. And then there's a bizarre way in which we're thinking about habits precisely as dependency. So he has the craving loop, right? So he says it's driven by craving. But think of someone like Felix Reveson in the 19th century, and he argues that habit is external impulses become spontaneous. That it's actually the spontaneous body providing what it was needed externally. So it's exact opposite of what Duhigg would actually consider to be habit. So to give you a concrete example, how many of you get phantom vibrations? None of you get, So that's the, so phantom vibrations are when your phone you think is vibrating and it's not, right?
Me too.
Isn't, like, and this is considered to be a sign of addiction, right? But isn't this really a sign of habituation? Like your body has, you know, spontaneously produces this thing, so you no longer need your phone, right? Isn't this what Rabinson calls habituation? And so why has this habituation become pathologized, right? You're a vague borderline hoarder if you're happy with what you have, right? So I think that that's what I'm talking about in terms of that move, and it's driven by the update, right? So just when you're about to habituate, there's the move to the next thing. In terms of habit and play, what's interesting about habit as well is in neurophysiology, they want to make the argument that the part of your brain that deals with habit is the oldest part of your brain, and that is evolutionarily links you to lizards, links you to everything else. And that, as Deleuze put it, and drawing from Hume, habit is the habit of forming habits. And that would fit into this whole question of play.
One more question concerning, is it on? That you said new media matters most when you no longer pay attention.
Right.
And of course I agree too, but other way around I think, or maybe it's more about how to pay attention, because new media is dependent on paying attention. We discussed that question of, is the screen no longer there? Where is the screen? How is interactivity possible? All this stuff. So maybe we can... would you agree to say that it's a question of how to pay attention, and in that situation, this the discursive elements of the dispositif come into play, or I think you call it extramedial material. Mm-hmm. So all the stuff that shows us and taught us how to deal with new media, mm-hmm. how to deal with ourselves interacting with new media, and mm-hmm. and it's kind of this everyday school of. Getting used to do things mm-hmm. in the good way, mm-hmm. in a way it should be done. And by this, learning to pay attention in a very special way mm-hmm. And to pay attention and to pay not attention in another way. Mm-hmm. That's why, for me personally, it's very important to work with interfaces on another level, to mm-hmm. see as we, as Thomas Elsesser said, was so important in the question of how could we establish watching films in universities. I think now we have to establish the same, maybe not the same, but a similar attention to interfaces as one of the most important mise-en-scène situations that we have right now. Mm-hmm. Never see a movie like Spike Jonze's Her, which is already off the topic. It's already without any, you know, it's no longer there. It's just you hear it. Mm-hmm. That maybe is the wake-up call that mm-hmm. we should now, when nearly the interfaces are nearly gone, sort of, pay attention, maybe only as historians.
Yeah. No, I think that's wonderful. I mean, Crary, of course, has the argument that distraction actually comes from attention. It's from having to pay attention to things that distraction emerges, right? And so there's a way in which these two are intimately intertwined. I think for me, to take your question, what I would focus on is the attending, and what does it mean to attend, to care for, and how can we think through this attending as a way to do something other than pay attention. To me would be the space that I think opens up.
Okay. Any other questions or remarks? Oh, yeah.
So just a brief question, and maybe you look at this in your book and maybe you don't, and if you do, you could elaborate. If you don't, it'd be interesting to hear why. But do you consider kind of internet memes where a kind of stock image is used over and over again, but there's only slight variation, is kind of exemplifying your exploration of this tension between habit and individuation, virality, and, you know, slow movement?
I think that's great. I don't... Part of it is because memes have become such the focus of virality that I don't deal with it directly except in the epilogue where I put it next to actually my reading of the book Chin. And say, instead of thinking about things in terms of memes, what if we think about things in terms of this collective habituation? And I think that and I do so precisely because I think there's been this emphasis as if the meme in itself explains everything. And I think that there's a way in which the repetition happens that's found in different ways, which is both surprising and interesting. But I do think that that whole question of what the work the meme does is really important.
It does seem that the logic of habituation is really important to the meme itself. Yes, it's not just the viral elements.
Absolutely, just the meme itself as meme, right? Absolutely, as opposed to the meme, right? And how we become used to the quotient of the meme. That's fantastic.
Yeah, please.
Thank you, Wendy. I have one question. Intrigue. As I understood, you said that algorithms are looking for faults, defaults, in order to learn. Mm-hmm. Then I asked myself, are algorithms more creative or more anti-habitus than human beings? When I remember the human beings dancing and in your video example.
That's a great question, and the way it's really interesting because machine learning is based on the idea that you need to learn from mistakes so that you finally have the perfect prediction. But at the same time, what's interesting, if you look at something like Netflix, and again, the ways in which now, in order to be predictable, they look for the moments in which you fork most from the mean, from the median, right? There's both this sort of feeding of the error, which actually defines the individual, is crucial to be compared and then used to predict the unpredictability of the individual, right? So there's a weird way in which the error is necessary, but also the thing that allegedly is dreamed to be erased. And I think that Phil Agee's early work on this, I think, is still fantastic. His piece, Capture Versus Surveillance, where he talks about capture systems and the ways in which they operate via grammar. I'm trying to think through the different grammars and the ways in which the grammars are constantly differing in order to have this sort of individuation.
So thank you very much for the conversation. Again, thank you very much, Wendy Chan.